Hachette Audio presents Anxiety, the Missing Stage of Grief, a revolutionary approach to understanding and healing the impact of loss. Written and read by Claire Bidwell Smith, LCPC. This program includes a Mac and PC compatible PDF of helpful checklists, charts, and references.
To everyone who has ever lost a loved one and lost themselves a little in the process, you are not alone. Introduction. If you are reading this book right now, it's probably safe to say that you or someone you love is struggling with anxiety. Not only that, but maybe you are just now connecting the dots to see that this anxiety may stem from a loss you've experienced in your life. That loss can be recent or decades old. Your anxiety could be severe or just enough to make your life uncomfortable. Anxiety is a tricky emotion, and I'm guessing that you're more than ready to figure out how to get a grip on it and learn how to feel good again. That's exactly what this book is designed to help you do. Anxiety that stems from loss is more common than most people realize. When someone we love dies, our world turns upside down on multiple levels. The shock of everything that comes with losing someone significant is a powerful catalyst for all the feelings of fear and dread that constitute anxiety. So I want to start by acknowledging that you are not alone in experiencing anxiety after a loss. Your loss could have happened just months ago, or you could still be grappling with the effects of a loss that occurred years earlier. Losing someone we love is an experience that stays with us all our lives, and the broader implications of a significant loss can manifest in all manner of life changes and behavioral and emotional triggers. This book is designed to speak to those who are in the first stages of processing their grief, and also to those who may no longer be actively grieving, but are experiencing the long-term effects of that initial grief, specifically anxiety. I've written this book to help you understand how to diminish and release that anxiety, while at the same time processing the loss that brought it on in the first place. I understand that simply acknowledging your anxiety can make you feel anxious, so I promise we're going to do this in a safe, comfortable, and compassionate way. In this book, I'm going to lead you step by step on a path to healing. It's the same path I took when I worked through my own anxiety following the deaths of my parents, and it's the same path down which I have led hundreds of clients in my work as a grief therapist. Know that there is light at the end of the tunnel, and that by reading these pages, you are taking the first steps toward healing your anxious heart. In my work as a grief therapist, I openly share my past with my clients. Because grief and anxiety are such particular experiences, I know it helps others feel more comfortable when they know that I have truly walked in their shoes. While I'm going to share many stories of how my clients overcame their own grief-related anxiety in later chapters, I want to begin by telling you a little of my story. I was 18 years old when I had my first panic attack. I was on a road trip with my high school boyfriend, Jordan. We had just graduated, and it was the summer between our senior year of high school and our freshman year of college. We were headed to separate schools in New England that fall and had decided to take a trip to visit each other's colleges, hoping to remain connected even after the summer. The trip had gone well. We saw each other's campuses, held hands as we walked across commons, and whispered vows of faithfulness in the face of distance. As we drove the two-day drive home to Georgia, we talked endlessly about all that was ahead of us. I stared out at the highway rushing before us, the future looming large, my sneakers propped on the dashboard and my hair blowing in the breeze from the open window. The future seemed exciting, but also a little scary. As I gazed out at the road, my heart suddenly did a little flip-flop, and then a bigger flip-flop. I yanked my feet off the dashboard and sat forward, breathing in deeply. My heart was racing and I felt dizzy. "What's wrong?" Jordan asked, but I couldn't answer him. I was too panicked to speak. Was I having a heart attack? The thought made me even dizzier. I felt as though there were a giant weight on my chest and I couldn't breathe. I shook my head at him, wide-eyed. "Something's wrong," I finally managed to say. Not knowing what else to do, Jordan followed highway signs to the nearest hospital emergency room and walked with me through the double doors. Several hours and multiple tests later, the doctor concluded that I'd had a series of heart palpitations, but that I was otherwise young and healthy, and he sent us on our way. From that day on, I lived in fear of having another episode like the one in the car. And in fact, I began to have them quite frequently. Chest pounding, heart racing and palpitating, severe dizziness. It was an awful problem, one that I quickly began to feel imprisoned by. Looking back on that initial visit to the emergency room, I so wish that the doctor had probed more into my psychology. If he had asked even just a few personal questions, he would have learned that I was in an extremely anxiety-provoking phase of life. I was about to move away from home for the first time, and both of my parents were battling cancer. Unfortunately, I was too young to correlate such events, and the attacks continued to plague me. The deceiving thing about anxiety is that it can manifest in such real physical symptoms that most people do not realize that anxiety is the source of their problem. In fact, it would take me many years to learn this for myself. But when I finally did, I was able to begin climbing out of this anxious phase of my life. I now help countless other people do the same. But it is the road on which I got here that taught me everything I know today about the affliction that is anxiety and how unresolved grief is inextricably woven into it. I was 14 when both of my parents got cancer at the same time. I was an only child, and the prospect of losing my family was something that loomed over me constantly throughout my adolescence. While my father's prostate cancer was treated easily and he quickly went into remission, my mother's late-stage colon cancer took our small family on a roller coaster of hospitals and doctors and seemingly endless treatments. My parents were wonderful people. They'd met and married late in life, both of them each other's third marriage. My father was an engineer and a World War II prisoner of war. My mother was a glamorous artist living in Manhattan. She was 40 and he was 57 when I was born. And even though my father had three grown children from his first marriage, my mother had always wanted one of her own. I was born in 1978 in Atlanta, and for a long time, our lives were good. But by the time I headed off to college, my father was in his 70s, and my mother's cancer had begun to win the five-year battle she'd been fighting. She died midway through my freshman year at a small liberal arts school in Vermont. I didn't make it in time to be by her side during her final moments. My mother's death rocked me. I was absolutely floored by it. Nothing could have prepared me for it. Not the 5 years we'd spent helping her combat her illness, not the talks my father had with me about her potential demise, not the school guidance counselor's sessions. The truth was, I never believed she would actually die. Because mothers don't die. Bad things don't actually happen. I now understand that the dismantling of those beliefs became the catalyst for my anxiety. When my mother's death disproved those two beliefs I'd so fervently held onto, the whole floor dropped out. If my mother could die, anything, absolutely anything, could happen. I took a hiatus from school and went back home to Georgia to help my father pack up and move out of our house. I got a job as a waitress, and I struggled to relate to my old friends from high school who came around to check on me. No one I knew had experienced so significant a loss. Everyone was sympathetic, but nonetheless, I felt very alone in my grief. The anxiety attacks continued to surface and even worsen. I lived in fear of having them, and I navigated a constant undercurrent of panic. I worried that my father was going to die at any moment. I worried that I would die. And less concrete than those fears, I simply felt a yawning dizziness at the idea that life was completely out of my control. I turned to alcohol to quell the anxiety, and I attached myself to a young man who had also recently lost a family member and was deep in the throes of his own grief. Together, we made our way to New York City, and it was there in a college psychology class where I realized for the first time what had happened all those years ago on the road trip with my high school boyfriend. I'd had a panic attack. Understanding this was the first step in my healing process. Recognizing that I had anxiety as a result of my mother's death actually helped me to better face the loss and enter into my grief. Losing someone we love is so deeply painful that we often turn away from the feelings rather than letting them course through us. But when we choose to push away difficult emotions, they don't just disappear. They simply fester beneath the surface, causing anger, frustration, and anxiety. But just because I finally understood what was happening didn't simply make it go away. The anxiety lingered and the panic attacks continued to surface now and then. When I brought up the idea of seeing a therapist, both my father and my boyfriend encouraged me to just push through and not to indulge further my feelings, which is what they thought would happen were I to enter into therapy. I now understand that the opposite would have been true. Grappling with anxiety is like driving a car on an icy road. When the car begins to skid, you need to turn with it in order to gain control, rather than trying to veer away. But at age 20, that's exactly what I was doing, veering away, pushing myself deeper into my studies and also into my relationship with alcohol. The anxiety continued to simmer. When I watched the Twin Towers fall from the roof of my East Village apartment in 2001, my anxiety reached an all-time high. It was no longer just my little microcosm that was at the mercy of mortality, but the world at large.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.